Hey, as I just explained, there is a Conservative MP leading a bid through the Commons to get grandparents, actually aunts and uncles as well, to have automatic access to their grandchildren, something which, unbelievably, some parents go out of their way to stop. It's a disgraceful attitude. There's some real nasty folk out there. Now, however, there is something called Knitting Nans, which is basically a grandmother organisation set up, by the way, by Fathers for Justice, a marvellous campaign. I wholly support Fathers for Justice. They set up Knitting Nans to try and give publicity to the grandmothers who are denied the right, for whatever reason, to see their grandchildren. Now, I have on the line right now a lady who is part of Knitting Nans. She's 72. She hasn't seen her granddaughter for 2 years. So the last time she saw her, she was 13. The girl is now 15. And she was one of those who staged a knitting in Parliament Square recently, in order to bring attention to the position A, she's in, but B, more generally, that many grandmothers are out there. I have her on the line right now. Hi there, Jenny.
Hello, Kelvin.
Jenny, can I just delve slightly into what on earth would have led you to not being able to speak to your granddaughter? Was there some family bust-up or a divorce?
Well, there was a divorce, but that was 10 years ago. And, you know, both my husband and I we've had a great relationship with her over the last 10 years. And then overnight, just contact had been denied. No reasons given. I've had no photographs, text messages unanswered, no response to birthday and Christmas presents.
How terrible. Do you know what the fundamental problem might be?
I think it could be something to do with maybe she was given a puppy.
Right.
She was brought a puppy, and it was all about the puppy and how she had to concentrate on the puppy and couldn't go on holiday with her father because she had these puppy to look after.
Mm. Anyway, whatever it was, it didn't really bear scrutiny. So
no.
Does your granddaughter live near you?
She lives a little way away, about an hour and a half away from me.
So there's no way of just bumping into her and having a coffee with her?
No, definitely not.
And
no.
How do you get on with the mother now, then?
I don't speak to her either. I mean, but I have never had a row with my ex-daughter-in-law. I always thought we got on really, really well together.
Yes, and of course, you are one of the victims of divorce and separation, aren't you? The real problem is where there is no blood, there is no link. It's a really, really horrible thing. And what about your son? How does he view all this?
Well, I mean, I'll say at the same time we're going through this, I've had to sit and watch my son be destroyed financially and emotionally.
Right.
When all he wants is to be part of his daughter's life. They got on so well together. If, you know, anyone would tell you that. I just don't understand. There's no reason.
Okay. Well, look, Jenny, you're now 72. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Your husband, how old is he?
He's the same age.
He's the same age. So what did you, when you staged that knit-in and you were able to talk to other grandmothers like yourself in the same position, was it helpful to you?
It was helpful, but also so sad. I mean, I just pray that we get a chance to see our granddaughter again. Some of the grandmothers I met had really, their children had really small children, and they're not going to ever remember. If they don't see their grandparents, they won't know them. At least with us, I feel that our granddaughter, she was 13. We'd seen her for 13 years. So hopefully she does, you know, she will remember us.
Yes. So, right. So, when you talk about it, I imagine it's one of those subjects where literally you talk about it all day long, one way and another, to your husband or your friends. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
It's one of those problems that you feel bubbling up almost in every conversation. Do you feel that?
I think I must have driven them crazy talking about it to my friends. I mean, all the time. And that's why, I mean, I approach Fathers for Justice with the idea of knitting the balls. Because I just think that the MPs haven't got the balls to actually take any action, you know, to run our family courts. And I'm hoping with the help of others to knit a pair for every member of the parliament. I want 650 pairs to give to every member of parliament.
Very, very, very funny that, Jenny. Well,
I'm going to sit on that. Yeah.
I've had Nigel Huddleston on the line just now, who is a Member of Parliament for Mid Worcestershire and a Conservative MP, who actually is trying to pilot a change in the Children's Act through the Commons. How confident are you that this is actually going to be enshrined in law?
Well, this is, I mean, I'd like to make sure that the court orders were just made enforceable for a start by law. Now, where is the Minister for Men and Boys? I mean, do we have one?
Well, we have it. I think we do have a children's minister. Why? Do you think that everything is aimed at, too much aimed at the female part of it?
Oh, definitely.
Do you?
I mean, I'm speaking on behalf of grandparents today. But I feel, what sad state of affairs that nobody is listening to our boys. Nobody's listening to them. Fathers for Justice worked so hard to try and change this. But, you know, it's desperate stuff, you know?
Yes, it is true. It is true that when you go through the courts, when women get very, very exercised during a divorce, they will deploy any form of nastiness, financial or, now, I'm saying this, or denial of the children to the father. And the Fathers for Justice have been fighting this for literally decades now. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure they've had much success, have they?
No, they just don't seem to be getting. They have to sort of pull pranks to get listened to. Why won't anybody take our boys seriously?
How close are you to your son?
Oh, very, very close. I just feel his pain. The pain, I mean, he goes through so much pain. And I go through that pain because I love him so much and I care about him.
But tell me this, how long has he been divorced now?
10 years.
So he's been divorced for 10 years. And
but he's seen her every. He had a court order where he saw her every weekend, every other weekend and every Sunday for 10 years. Took her on holiday. I've been on holiday with them. She stayed here on holiday and just, you know, going to court doesn't cut the mustard. I tell you, it's awful. I mean, it's not worth the money. The money that's been spent, and to come away and have it taken away from you, a court order suspended.
Okay, tell me, so when is the last time your son saw his daughter then?
2 years ago.
Oh, well, he's denied seeing her as well, is he?
Yes, oh yes. And because he's denied seeing her, I'm denied seeing her.
Can I just ask you, Jenny, that's most unusual. Why was he denied seeing her?
Well, I don't know. Because the court, when he went to court, the mother stood in court and said that her daughter didn't want to see the father. And the judge just agreed with that and said, okay, well, you know, maybe go to mediation, I'll suspend this court order. But the child has never had to say. We've never heard from the child, just that it's what the mother has told the judge. He's believed, and this is what's happening. The grandmothers I spoke to on the other day, basically, they believe everything the mother says. They can just lie through their teeth.
Right, well, I think we have to be slightly careful about that, about whether they were lying or not. But I do accept that the courts seem to accept too easily the views of the female side of the argument, and the male side is considered wrong, or there's some aspect to them which is unattractive, where, of course, there's unattractive on both sides.
I understand that marriages and relationships break down, but it's not being an excuse to stop one parent from seeing their child or their grandparent. It should be all about their child and their well-being.
These
are men that love their children and want to be part of their lives.
Well, I I would like to say to you that at least you have what looks like all-party support in the Commons. It's not going to be easy to get this thing through, because the idea that that everybody ends up, the grandparents, the aunts and the uncles, start taking the younger members of the family to court to get access is not going to be easy. But look, Jenny, it's a very upsetting story, and I accept totally that your family has been devastated by this. What we got, that was pretty upsetting, that stuff. I'm sure there are examples everywhere of these rather nasty parents denying the grandparents the rights. It really makes me very